It was a tragic moment, and there was no doubt about it. They had united their lives through death with the Salvadoran community, and it was a message that was going to be shouted out to the world, whereas the then 25,000 deaths, which now has gone up to 75,000, you know, wouldn't get through.
Well, around 1 o'clock in the morning, the house was surrounded by maybe 150 soldiers. Nine of them broke into the house. They took the six Jesuits away from their rooms, and five of them were killed on the spot. You could see on the walls pieces of their brains, blood, and so on. Then they realized that another door was open. They looked into it and found Julia Elba and Celina, and they shot them. Then later, they went into the first floor of the pastoral center, and they destroyed totally several offices, especially when they found expensive material like computers and so on. They also machine gunned pictures of Archbishop Romero, some books, some windows, and then they left.
Ten years ago today, four American nuns were raped and killed by soldiers in El Salvador. The murders marked the start of a decade of persecution of the Catholic Church by the armed forces. It culminated in the killing last year of six prominent Jesuits by army commandos. This is the story of three people who've been brought together by the two massacres and who've managed to draw strength and hope from terror.
It never occurred to me that my sister, as a missionary, as an American citizen, would be killed in a place like El Salvador.
We see there the drama, really, of all our lives, which is a dying and a rising. And I see that happening very clearly in El Salvador. And I see the rising of a church, of faith, the people of faith, that really understands that God gets upset when little people are pushed around.
Well, the last 10 years of the church in El Salvador have been very difficult because it began with and ends with martyrs. I think the wonderful thing is the decision to go on.
Bill Ford and his sister Ita grew up in New York. They then chose very different paths. Ita went to serve the poor in Latin America as a missionary. Bill embarked on a successful career as a Wall Street lawyer.
Before Ita's death, I really didn't know her. I was just the patronizing, wise older brother. After her death, 10 years after her death, I have come to realize that my sister was really a giant, and it is she who was really holding my hand and making me understand many things I had no glimmer of before. Ita was one of four American Marinol sisters in El Salvador. Marinol is the foreign missionary arm of the American Catholic Church. She understood, before most people in my country understood, exactly what was wrong with El Salvador, but her voice, unfortunately, was ahead of its time, yet it was effective enough to cause her death. We were getting letters through November and December of 1980, and in fact, we got a postcard from Ita, which she wrote December 1st, the day before she was murdered by the Salvadoran security forces, that she had just heard about the birth of my son, John. She didn't know it was a boy or a girl, but she was rejoicing with us and looking forward to getting to a telephone to find out the details of our new baby. I was devastated to think that someone who was so appreciative of life, so caring for life, could have been wasted in such a cruel and useless way. After I met with the U.S. government and realized that my government had no interest in a homicide investigation, but was really dealing with a political problem, I visited El Salvador and I began to realize the importance of what Ida was doing, the importance of Ida, and I was determined that Ida and the other women would not be forgotten.
Working with one of America's foremost human rights groups, Bill helped to convict his sister's killers. In 1984, five members of the Salvadorian National Guard were sentenced to 30 years in jail for the crime. But the violence against Salvadorians continued. Bill decided it would not stop as long as the Salvadorian military was receiving over $1 million a day from the United States, so he began to campaign for an end to U.S. military aid.
I would not stand by and permit my government to ship more guns, bombs, and bullets to a government that was killing its own people. So I decided that I would do everything I could to call the attention of the United States people and the United States Congress to the fact that the United States was part of the problem in El Salvador. It was not part of the solution. I and other members of the family have gone down to El Salvador. I've been down there six times. I've testified before the Congress four times. I have spoken throughout the country. I have met with officials of the Catholic Church. And I have done everything that I reasonably could to make sure that people understood the focus of their lives as Catholic missionaries trying to bring a sense of human decency and spiritual values to a people undergoing tremendous suffering. My sister was not a political agent of anyone. If she was an agent of anybody, it was Jesus Christ. This trip that I'm going on now is part of a continuing quest on my part to find out about my sister so I can explain her to my 9-year-old son, who never met her.
When Ita Ford arrived in 1980, El Salvador was on the brink of civil war. At the heart of the conflict was land. In a country of 4.5 million, almost all the land was owned by just 14 families. The armed forces had assumed the role of defending this elite against any protest by the poor. The poor, for their part, were forced to live on the margins, in conditions of extreme hardship and often in close proximity to the rich. This forced them to confront the cause of their misery. But demands for reform were met by the armed forces with terror. Death squads roamed the slums and sought out suspected political activists.
75,000 people have been killed, at times in terrible massacres, absolutely defenseless. Old men, women, children. Around 5,000 people have disappeared, which means they are dead. Tortures have been, and still are to some degree, brutal, unbelievable. Captures without any justification. So we live in a culture of fear. That's what. And the most tragic aspect of it is that this cruelty is a response to the decision of the poor simply to cease to be poor.
Open war broke out between the army and left-wing guerrillas. The church tried to remain politically neutral, but working with the poor was perceived as siding with the left.
The church here and the Jesuits have made an option for justice and for the poor. This is the option that Jesus made, is the option that prophets like Isaiah and Micah made. So that doesn't make the church communist. That makes the church simply Christian. What happens, though, is that there are people who don't like this type of church. They don't like it. And then, since they dislike it, try to call the church communist.
Archbishop Oscar Romero was originally a conservative, but the violence produced a profound change of heart, and he threw the church behind the struggle for justice. Romero knew it was dangerous. He even predicted his own death, but he also insisted that the church had to share the suffering of ordinary Salvadorians. That was why, as he put it, killing priests is good news. It was a shocking statement. Far more shocking, however, was Romero's own fate. On March the 24th, 1980, he was shot down while saying Mass in a chapel. El Salvador's church had found a true martyr. Originally from the Spanish Basque Country, John Sobrino has spent 40 years in El Salvador. Romero was a close personal friend, and the ideas he stood for have inspired Sobrino's theology. It's a theology that is seen as highly subversive.
We tell the truth in a country of light, in a country which exercises a fantastic cover-up. Second, we try to defend the victims of the system. So the very wealthy, the oligarchy, the armed forces, and even governments cannot subsist if there are not as many poor as there are today. Telling the truth and supporting the poor is the sin we have committed.
Sobrino teaches at the Catholic University. Here, throughout the 1980s, he and other Jesuit intellectuals insisted that the root causes of the violence were poverty and injustice. This made them obvious targets.
This university has a history of maybe 20 years of persecution. Certainly verbal attacks on the newspapers, on television. We have been called absolutely everything. Criminals, atheists, Marxists, certainly, and then physical attacks. On 15 or 16 occasions, a bomb had exploded at the printing press very often. At the offices of our journals, at the computer center, and also the administration building.
In November last year, Sobrino left for a lecture tour in Thailand. The trip was to save his life. At the height of a major guerrilla offensive, a large group of soldiers raided the Jesuit quarters and murdered six of Sobrino's associates. The dead men were accused of instigating the guerrilla offensive. In fact, they were political moderates who'd encouraged dialogue between the government and guerrillas. The Jesuits' cook and her daughter were also killed.
I felt at the very, very beginning that life and I myself was absolutely unreal. That I had lost all my relations to the real world. So you can understand that. I felt angry against, those who were responsible. But then simultaneously, this feeling gave me some sort of deep consolation. these people have been killed because they have shown a great love. And since I don't see too much of it around the world, to have experienced love, even though through such a tragedy, as I said, gave me some interior peace. The death of these Jesuits is good news because it tells us it is possible to be a human being on this earth, and to be human, not to be ashamed of living on this planet. The price to pay was terrible, of course. That's the bad news. But, you know, still, that's what I mean by good news. It is possible for us to be human, believers and Christians.
Sabrino attends a mass at Juan Curita, a small settlement in the war zone. Four children were killed here recently when an Air Force helicopter bombed the village during a skirmish. But the villagers have drawn strength from the tragedy. They've renamed their settlement after Ignacio Ellacuría, one of the murdered Jesuits. Several foreign sympathizers attend the ceremony.
It's a symbol of what this country can become if really peace comes to the country and justice and solidarity from abroad. That's why I think Ignacio Ellacuría was very, very happy. It's terrible, of course, that six Jesuits are assassinated. But the worst thing would be, I think, if the university as such would disappear. I think the Salvadoran people would be even more defenseless. But I invite people to come here, honestly, because I think it's good for them. It's good for them.
The South Bronx, New York City. One of North America's grimmest slums, but also home to a man who's accepted Sabrino's invitation.
And then they'll accuse the people of the South Bronx of being slobs.
The New York law summaries.
Dean Brackley, a Jesuit priest, came to work in the Bronx in 1980. The parish he took over has a large Hispanic community.
Here in our South Bronx community, involved in trying to change U.S. policy in Central America for a number of years. And eventually I got a chance in 1984 to visit El Salvador. I was deeply moved by the experience. Similar to what I described to you earlier about the South Bronx, except that this was under conditions of war. I was appalled by the suffering I heard about, the torture. I was appalled by the thought of U.S. bombs dropping on civilians. Overcome by that. And yet, there too, and maybe more than in the South Bronx, this extraordinary faith. When this tragedy happened last November, of the murders of the eight at the UCA, I was shocked. And shocked more than I would have ever thought I would be shocked. Really depressed me. And a few days later, the thought came to me, gee, maybe I'd want to go. Maybe I should, maybe it's appropriate for me to volunteer.
Some 200 foreigners volunteered to take the place of the dead Jesuits in El Salvador. Dean Brackley was one of the six chosen.
I was euphoric. I found out right here in this house, I was just quite surprised. I had an inkling that I might be chosen, but I was also shocked by that, because frankly, your life will never be the same. You know, mine will never be the same. This is one of those decisions and changes.
because I feel badly that, to some extent, I wasn't really focused on what she was doing while she was alive. I want to learn more about her. I want to meet more people who work with her in El Salvador.
Naomi, a Salvadorian nun, was one of those who worked with Ita.
After the service, I had an opportunity to go with Naomi into one of the slum areas in which she worked. Just as a setting in which to live, it was awful. There were open sewers running in front of these shanty towns. The shanty towns were made of corrugated metal, which had to become ovens. And yet, in the face of this terrible environment, one of the things that struck me was the quiet dignity and the peace of the people. It'd be foolish to say that they were happy to be there. Obviously, that sense of dignity and purpose is hard to maintain during unemployment or seeing your children go hungry. But the attraction, I think, of the Salvadorans to Ita, and certainly the attraction to me, is that they are largely a people of great dignity and great peace. After we walked through the shanty town and had an opportunity to talk to some of the people, I went back to Naomi and I spoke to her at somewhat greater length about her work. And she told me that she and her community had received a death threat, that a death squad had broken into her house, ransacked the house, and left a note saying that you're not here now, but we'll come back and get you.
Nos catearon, registraron todo lo que pudieron encontrar de papeles, buscaron. Dejaron dos cruces rojas, ¿verdad? Con pintura y con brocha las hicieron, una en el planchador de la casa y otra por el comedor. Y además de eso nos dejaron un papel que ya lo llevaban escrito a máquina en el que decían a todas y a todos, venimos a buscarles a casa y no les encontramos, buscamos lo que queríamos y no lo hallamos, volveremos. Frente a eso se siente temor. El temor es humano y se siente, pero al mismo tiempo es la señal de que algo estamos haciendo por la causa de Jesús, por la causa de los pobres. En ese sentido, ha sido para nosotros una gracia. Además de tener miedo, han significado una gracia, porque nos hemos sentido que no estamos solos. Y podemos compartir también con los demás miembros con nuestro pueblo. Y con mucha más razón ahora vamos a seguir adelante hasta donde Dios nos conceda vida para poder seguir trabajando por su reino aquí en nuestro país, en El Salvador.
I was overwhelmed at the thought that someone could be threatened with murder, as Ita had received the death threat before she was killed, and look at it as a grace from God. But it also means to me that the military continue to be afraid of men and women who are working with the poor. The military continue to be afraid of people who are working with the poor and helping them to come to an understanding of what the gospel means. The military, who are armed with millions and even billions of dollars of U.S. aid, are afraid of unarmed nuns with crosses and Bibles. I come to Chalatenango for a personal purpose, for almost a personal pilgrimage, because each time I come, I think that I understand Ita a little better. Ita clearly loved this town. Ita and Carla and Mora are buried in Chalatenango because it is a Marinol tradition that Marinolas who are out on mission are buried where they die. I think that Ita, I know Ita moved around a lot, but I know that she always came back here. I was pleased and I was saddened to visit the rooms where Ita and Mora lived. I was pleased because the work is obviously being carried on. It's a live, vibrant place. There are young people coming in and out.
It appears to be the headquarters of pastoral efforts here in Chalatenango. I was upset to see that the room where Ida lived is a warehouse for grain and food and medicine, which should be distributed to the people in and around Chalatenango, but which can't be distributed because the army garrison will not permit the food to go out of town. So, in one sense, the problems that Ida faced haven't changed at all in 10 years. As I walk around the town, I try to imagine it as it must have been when Ida is here. And I'm particularly pleased to see the number of children in the town and in the church. It's upsetting to see the number of soldiers in the town. It's upsetting to me to see that these soldiers are all clothed and armed with American weapons. And sometimes I make the calculation of how much milk or bread or medicine you could buy for each of the American trucks we see drive by, or for each of the American helicopters.
It's difficult to describe how one feels at arriving at a place like El Salvador. I have the impression of meeting a lost love, with all the nervousness and the fear of perhaps not being accepted or not doing a good job, not of being incapable. But really, it's very difficult to talk about how one feels here, because feelings are a jumble arriving here. It was especially nice to see John Sobrino as I came into the airport. John put a face on this strange land that will now be my home. And John also represents for me just a collaborator, someone who will help me to know the new ropes, but also a colleague, a theologian, with whom it'll be a great advantage and help to work.
Well, I think, and I hope he'll do a good job. Well, his experience with the poor United States makes it easier for him. So I hope he'll enjoy himself.
It looks as though I will be teaching ethics, mainly to students of theology and students of philosophy. So for now, just two courses. The philosophy course to undergraduates, the theology course I'll be teaching to what we call here pastoral agents, that would be seminarians, some priests, some sisters, some leaders of base communities. And I'll be working, doing pastoral work on the weekends in Hayake, a parish about 45 minutes outside the capital. Working in a parish like Hayake brings a middle-class person back to what's important in life, struggling for survival and taking care of one another. That's what life's about, and a middle-class person, a university professor, easily can forget that. I think Hayake's going to be more important to me than I'll be to them.
Porque yo fui donde el doctor el lunes, pero fui de parte donde yo trabajo.
Sí. ¿Y le dan consulta gratis?
Exactamente, me dan una consulta y bien, bien tratado.
This was Don Beto. Don Beto told us that most of his family had been recently sick. He was very concerned about that. Don Beto explained to us that he spends 3 hours commuting to work and 3 hours commuting back. Works in a factory in the capital. He makes 700 colones, which is really less than $100 a month. He spends 200 of that getting to and from work, which leaves him with really a pittance to clothe and feed his children. And when a sickness like this touches his family, it can really threaten disaster. And yet, here is a man who had never, of course, seen me, and opens his entire life to me in such a friendly and open way. You can see on the one hand the goodness of this people, their openness and trust, and at the same time their vulnerability in the face of this war and the type of repression that poor communities suffer. Why does the church get involved in what looks like some people would say material concerns, right? Health in Hayake, garbage in the South Bronx. The point is not really garbage in the South Bronx. The point is injustice. Injustice is a lack of love. Where love is absent, God is absent. God is concerned about community, about people. Right? So that the question of the poor, the question of social justice, is a far more essentially religious issue than the question of cult, of rosaries, of mass, which are also important. But if we have to choose between one or the other, the Bible is very clear. Don't come tramping into my temple at the same time that you're trampling the poor.
Jesus of Nazareth on this earth was a rather humble, poor human being. And he said, whether we accept it or not, that's another problem, I will be present, not at the Vatican, not at universities, not at curias of bishops or archbishops. I will be present where people are hungry, where people are thirsty. We all know that, Matthew 25. Now, if this is so, it's absolutely important for the church to have the poor in the middle of it so that we can learn today in the 20th century really who Jesus of Nazareth is. I think to be poor in El Salvador means to be near death. And I mean this very seriously. So if you are poor, it means you will die sooner or earlier than if you are a Jesuit or an average European. These people have never decided to commit collective suicide. They haven't. And they have hope. And that's something I learned from them. I would also say that I learned the sense of community. Again, individualism is one of the worst negative products of the Western world, individualism. Now, these people know very well that if they don't come together, they cannot survive. But not only that, they enjoy living as community. And, I could go on and on, but I will add one more thing. I have the experience of being forgiven. What do I mean by this? Well, I belong to a social class, middle class, and I come from a country, in this case, the Basque country, Spain, which, say, structurally speaking, is ultimately responsible for their poverty. Now, when I go to see them, logically, I could expect that they would reject me. What are you doing here? Or that they would say, well, typically Jesuit or typically Christian, you come here late. Well, they don't react that way. They open their houses, if they have any. They open their arms, their hearts. They give us whatever they have, which may be a cup of coffee or a glass of water. And they don't know that. But what they are doing is simultaneously telling me it's true, you are different. You come from a different world, for the world of oppression, but we accept you. And that's, for me, the experience of being forgiven. And I think it's a very healthy experience. The first world offers optimism in progress. TV sets will be better. And the Olympics in 92 will be better than in 88. But progress is not human fulfillment. So it offers optimism, but not hope. The reservoir of humanity, of humanness, it is not in the first world anymore. That's my conviction. It is in the third world.
Sobrino is a man who has worked on this theology, the poor, liberation theology, as it's sometimes called. And not only that, but he is a man who is doing important and prophetic work with the knowledge that he could be killed any day as his six friends were killed. I come down to El Salvador for visits, and then I go back to the relative safety of the United States. I come down here to meet with and be inspired by people with the courage and the clear voice of a John Sobrino.
Well, tell your mother, because it's true, there are many, many people in El Salvador, you know, these poor people who love Ita very much. That's very important. And also that, say, for other sisters, Ita and Maura and the others are a real source of inspiration. So every year, as you know, at the anniversary, especially the sisters get together and simply they say, we'll go on. Now, this is very important. In a situation like the situation of El Salvador, to maintain hope and to have sources of hope and inspiration is very important. So thank your mother for Ita. Really.
Ten years ago today, on December the 2nd, 1980, Ita Ford returned from a conference in Nicaragua with another Mary Knoll sister. They were met at the airport by two friends. Shortly afterwards, their van was intercepted by five members of the Salvadorian National Guard, who drove the four women to an isolated spot. Ita's colleagues waited anxiously for news. One of them still works in El Salvador.
In speaking with Madeline Dorsey, I was talking to one of Ita's best friends, even though they only knew each other for a fairly short time. It was a very difficult conversation, but it was a rewarding conversation to hear her describe the events of the day that Ita was killed.
Well, it was like a whole night's vigil. We had mass at 5 o'clock in the morning, asking the intercession of Lord that they would be found and found alive. In the meantime, that early that morning, the car was found. It was terribly burned. It burned almost to a cinder. I've never seen anything on one burning, you know, tires, everything were gone and nothing in it. But they identified the motor. So we knew that they had been captured. And finally, about noon, a call came that someone had informed that four white women had been buried in the Hacienda San Francisco. And even then, it is, you know, one hangs on to that wisp of hope. Then finally, we got the police, we got a grave digger, and went to the site. They were there, the ambassador was there. Just a poignant detail, in removing the bodies, Jean's was first, and then Dorothy's, and Morris, and Ita's. And Ita was placed very close to them where we were and where we knelt down. There was a lot of jungle grass, tangled grass. It was very hard to get around, and by that time there were a lot of people in the area. And Ita had a dirty little face, and I went over and knelt down. Brushed it off a little and replaced her hand. So it was a moment of righteous anger, too. For the horror of the crime, and a very purposeful crime, because they weren't unidentified women.
going to the site where Eater is killed is an exercise really in turning off my mind, turning off my imagination. If you don't turn off your imagination, I know I would just be paralyzed with grief or rage, and I think we have to go on. I think Ida's life, Maura's life, Dorothy and Jean's lives were too important for us to be paralyzed by grief.
Martyrdom adds to being assassinated simply that martyrs have had a great love. They are killed because they have loved the people. That's why it's so important for us to remember our martyrs. We are not masochists. Maybe we are obsessed, but we are not masochists. But we are grateful to our martyrs because they have shown a great love. I thought about death. On March the 12th, 77, Rutilio Grande, a Jesuit, a good friend of mine, was murdered. I think that day I told God that I was ready to follow that path if that helps to the liberation of the Salvadoran people. And since then, I've never thought about that again.
Romero said prophetically, when the first priest was killed in El Salvador, these are very strong words, that it would be a tragedy if the people of El Salvador were dying under such terrible conditions and not a single priest were to die. Would we have the courage to stand up under trial? Would we have the courage to live, to stand up for the truth and to defend the poor in the face of a threat? That's the real issue that the deaths of the Jesuits raise for us. And it asks us a question about our own adequacy. Frankly, I feel quite inadequate. And I guess I'd have to say I look for strength outside myself to be able to stand up to any such challenge.
One of the phenomena of violent death is that it doesn't go away. I don't think a day goes by when I don't think of Ida. In coming down to El Salvador, I think that each time, each visit brings me a little closer to an understanding of Ida. And in learning about Ida, I'm learning something about myself, because I think I and other people have to come to terms of what we're going to do to continue the work of these women. A lot of people have asked whether Eater and other foreign missionaries have any business in this place, but thinking first just of the men and women in general who come down here, I think their presence is important as witnesses. I think their presence is important as witnesses to the gospel. I think their presence is important as witnesses to the acts and the brutality of the Salvadoran government against its own people. I mean, clearly, I wish Ida were alive. Clearly, I wish I was talking to Ida rather than talking about her. But I'm proud of the fact that Ida's life made a difference. Ida strongly believed that one person could make a difference. And I think that the lives of Ida, of Maura, and Dorothy, and Jean have made a difference to thousands of people. They've made a difference to me, and I think they have made a difference for the Salvadoran people.
We see death in the church in defense of life. We see solidarity in Hayake. We see non-poor people joining the poor. and sharing to some extent their struggles and their risks in the service of life. The Jesuits died in defense of life, and Romero died in defense of life. The life of the poor, when the poor are defended, we all have a better chance for life.
Of course, I miss my friends in community life. I knew them very well. The jokes they used to tell. We had shared so much for so many years. I miss them at the university. Now, when I have certain problems, they are not there to help me. I miss them, but I would say it's not, and I'm honest, it's not the profoundest feeling I have towards them. When I see their pictures, especially Ilya Kuria smiling and the others, I feel some sort of mixture of healthy pride. And although I don't go into tears, I don't. But in those occasions, I almost go into tears. It's a good feeling. So, as I said, the thought that they have loved, they have been on this earth with mercy towards others, working for justice towards others, that thought is more powerful for me than knowing that they are not here anymore.